This is a podcast lecture focusing on vulvodynia. It's designed mainly for health professionals, but some patients might find it of interest. My name is David Nunns, and I work in Nottingham in the gynaecology department there. I have a vulval clinic once a fortnight and see many women with vulval disease, including vulvodynia. In this lecture, I wanted to cover the following topics: a little bit about the causes of vulval pain, how to assess a woman with vulvodynia, a bit about management of vulvodynia, covering a little bit about the framework of care for health professionals when it comes to managing patients with vulvodynia, and to finally focus on the work of the Vulval Pain Society. This picture shows a normal vulva in a postmenopausal woman. When we talk about the vulva, we talk about the external female genitalia. As you can see laterally, there's the hair-bearing labia majora, the inner folds of skin are the labia minora, clitoris hood at the top, and the perineum between the anus and the vagina. Centrally in this patient, it's quite obvious to see the vestibule area. This is the area of skin between the lower part of the vagina and the labia minora, and in this patient it looks quite red. This doesn't imply any evidence of inflammation, but it's quite normal because the skin in this area is thinner. The vulva is richly innervated by nerve endings, and it's the site of a number of primary skin conditions such as lichen sclerosis and lichen planus, but it can also be involved as a skin surface with skin disease elsewhere such as psoriasis and eczema. Things can get complicated on the vulva because it's the sexual organs, so there can be a number of knock-on effects on an individual's sex life, but also the skin comes into contact with a lot of potential irritants such as over-the-counter products, topical treatments, and even urine. So things can get complicated, and sometimes there can be more than two things going on the vulva at once, particularly with chronic patients. This is the framework that I use when I see a patient with a difficult vulval problem. Because as mentioned before, sometimes patients might have a couple of problems going on at the same time. I divide the framework up into infection, inflammation of the vulva, i.e. skin conditions, neoplastic problems, and pain syndrome problems. I think this is helpful because some patients, for example, with lichen planus might need a vulvodynia type strategy because many of these patients present with pain. And also some patients, for example, with lichen sclerosis can have a secondary candidal infection. I'm not going to talk about infection or the cancerous, precancerous conditions of the vulva because I think those problems are quite easily diagnosed by most doctors. But I just wanted to briefly mention vulval eczema. This is the commonest condition that we would see within a vulval clinic. And there are different types of vulval eczema, which is essentially itchy, inflamed skin. Now, most eczema is fairly obvious after taking history and examining the patient, but sometimes very subtle eczema can produce very small fissures or splits in the skin that present with a vulval pain problem, and these can easily be missed and overlooked. These are often like very small paper cuts, and the vulva needs to be examined closely to detect them. Now, the management of vulval eczema is to essentially look for a potential irritant on the skin, an over-the-counter product, a topical treatment, and it may be something like urine or even sanitary pads. This should be withdrawn. A moisturiser is essential, and the moisturiser of choice would be something such as Cetraban. and this can be used regularly and liberally. Sometimes patients itch with their vulval eczema at night time, and therefore an antihistamine can be helpful. And the treatment for eczema, the mainstay of treatment, is going to be a steroid ointment in a reducing regime for around 3 months. Very important to give patient written information. I wanted to mention lichen planus because this can also present with vulval pain. And these patients often have an overlap with lichen sclerosis, which is another itchy inflammatory skin condition. But in lichen planus, soreness is the main presenting complaint rather than itch. Sometimes there's a profuse vaginal discharge and the appearances can be very subtle. So it's very important to look at not only the vulva but the vagina in all patients who present with pain to not overlook some subtle lichen planus. When this is involved in the vagina, it's called erosive lichen planus. When managing lichen planus, the treatment is going to be similar to our treatment for lichen sclerosis. Very potent topical corticosteroids such as Dermavate on a reducing regime. Scarring and narrowing of the vagina can happen, particularly with vaginal involvement. And sometimes for vaginal disease, we use intravaginal steroids such as the Predfoam enemas that we used for inflammatory bowel disease. These patients do need long-term follow-up and occasionally systemic treatment under a specialist dermatologist interested in lichen planus. Vulval fissures are the final skin disease I want to mention before moving on to vulvodynia, because these very small fine paper cuts in the skin can be a cause of vulval pain. Now they can occur as a part of another skin problem such as eczema or even lichen sclerosis, but they can just develop in isolation. The treatment of this problem is difficult, but the general approach is to treat the underlying skin problem if there is one, with the steroids and the emollients mentioned before. Massage the area or any other desensitization technique is helpful, and surgery really is a last resort to cut out the area of the fissure. This picture shows a patient who's got a posterior forceps fissure. These patients are often quite phobic about touch and quite apprehensive about intercourse, so it's important to ask about any psychosexual problems, in particular vaginismus. I think it's important to cover the skin problems before moving on to vulvodynia, because sometimes a diagnosis of vulvodynia can be given to a patient and a subtle skin problem can be overlooked. This paper was published in 2008 by Bowen et al. From an American clinic, where vulval biopsy was carried out on most of the patients attending the clinic who had vulval pain. And they found that in 61% of women who were diagnosed by the referring clinician with vulvodynia, there was a clinically relevant skin problem. And this was often eczema, lichen sclerosis, or irritant dermatitis. So I think it's very important before a diagnosis of vulvodynia is given to do a proper assessment of the patient with a full history and examination. Vulvodynia is the term that we use to describe women who experience vulval pain in the absence of any skin disease or infection. So these are not women who've got fissuring or with lichen sclerosis. These are not women who've got evidence of vaginal infections. This is essentially a problem of the nerve endings, the nociceptors in the skin. Now this can produce an unprovoked pain picture or a provoked pain picture. And in our up-to-date classification on this slide, we're going to want to try and identify where the patient feels pain. Is it clitoral pain, one-sided pain, or is it localised to the vestibular area? The term we used to use, vestibulitis, has now been replaced with a term called vestibulodynia, where there is pain on touch localised to the vestibule. Dynia means burning, and allodynia is the phenomenon when light touch produces a pain sensation. I think there are good and bad things about having a diagnosis of vulvodynia. No doubt for the patient this is a good thing because it gives the woman a diagnosis. It allows her to focus perhaps on an appropriate treatment strategy related to the pain, and it would encourage doctors not to prescribe repeat antifungals to any women who've got chronic vulval pain. The disadvantages, however, of having a diagnosis of vulvodynia is that you have a wide spectrum of pain perception in the women that we see, so that we have in one extreme one woman who with constant pain, who is unable to move because of a vulval pain, perhaps needing strong pain relief, and at the other extreme you might get a woman who has a variable, even minimal amount of pain on touching the vestibule, and this might just be during intercourse, but it's something that she can self-manage and doesn't require any medical intervention for. And in the middle, you've got a wide variety of women who are coming towards health professionals wanting treatment for a pain problem. What I think may be happening is that when we see patients as doctors with vulvodynia, we give the diagnosis too soon and launch into a treatment strategy without really appreciating what is the individual impact on the woman of the pain. And I think this is very important because it's that individual experience of pain that's going to determine what sort of strategy you give to the patient for pain relief. We're still not clear as to the cause of vulvodynia. We know that there is no subtle underlying infection in these patients. There is no hidden skin disease on biopsies, and there's no evidence of a back problem that might be referring pain to the vulva, which is why we don't do, as a matter of routine, vulval biopsies and MRI scans on patients who present with pain. What we do see in the histories of these women very regularly is a story of recurrent attacks of vulvovaginal thrush or cystitis type problems. And what we also know on biopsies taken from women with vulvodynia, that there is an increased number of nerve endings in the skin. So the question is, does a past history of inflammation of the vulva lead to a chronic pain problem as seen in vulvodynia? There seems to be evidence now that a history of inflammation through recurrent thrush can lead to the problem of vulvodynia, at least in experimental animal studies. This is a study published in September 2011 and involved giving mice recurrent attacks of vulvovaginal thrush and treating them with Diflucan, an antifungal. And the aim of the experiment was to try and show whether an allodynia response or a vulvodynia type picture would develop in mice with repeated attacks of thrush. Now, the assessment of the mice to the recurrent attacks of thrush in terms of pain was using small monofilament von Frese fibers, which are used on the vulvas and as a control the hind feet of mice, to try and demonstrate a response to pain by gentle pressure. Now, What they found was that when the mice had two attacks of thrush treated by Diflucan, that there was no allodynia response after these two infections subsided. But after a third attack of thrush and treatment, 40% of the mice continued it with a sustained allodynia response. In addition, another experiment, there was a prolonged attack of thrush without treatment in the mice, which produced a sustained allodynia response in the mice. This suggests that recurrent attacks of thrush, despite treatment, can produce sustained changes in nerve ending function, i.e. allodynia. When the histology of the vulva was looked at, there was no evidence of inflammation. So this pain that was experienced was not related to inflammation, but they did find that there was an increase in nerve endings, i.e. proliferation of nerve fibres in the skin. When they tried to look at the allodynia response in another experiment in the mice by producing a similar reaction to the fungus and assessing the allodynia response, it was very variable. And the questions are, really, are there genetic reasons amongst the different mice to account for the variable response to allodynia? So these are unknown questions, but it certainly seems from this study that inflammation is linked to producing an allodynia-type chronic pain problem that we see in vulvodynia in humans. I think it's very important to take a proper pain history from patients, because what we really want to do is develop a profile of this individual's level of pain and its impact on function. So the site of the pain is important. To me, patients who've got one-sided vulval pain may have a problem with a low coccyx or a low back problem to account for their pain, for example. Patients where they're, again, who have radiation of the pain from their vulva down the thigh, even into the leg, and even up into the back, that may indicate not so much a vulvodynia, but a referred pain to the vulva for a low back problem. What are the aggravating relieving factors? Well, an example would be pudendal neuralgia, which is a nerve entrapment syndrome where the pudendal nerve is squeezed in its sheath in the pudendal canal when the patient sits. And so the classical history that patients with the pudendal neuralgia complain of is pain on sitting, but relieved by standing and lying flat. And they also experience the feeling of a lump or a pressure inside the vagina. I think this is important because these patients may need to be seen for a discussion, for example, with a pain management team about a pudendal block as one of many treatments that those patients can receive. And also the severity of the pain, I think, is very important. This can be just a very subjective assessment of pain using a simple "how bad is your pain" question to the patient, or it can be objective using a pain scale. And there are a number of questionnaires patients can fill in for this. But this is important because a patient whose pain may be very minimal, and she may be unaccepting of drugs such as the tricyclics or gabapentin because of its potentially sedative effects. Whereas a patient whose pain is very maximal, 8, 9 out of 10 on a pain scale, would be very keen to take some of these drugs despite the side effects. So it's important to gauge the severity of pain to decide on which treatment options the patient wishes to pursue. I also ask about sexual pain, very important, particularly with patients with provoked pain, because sometimes It becomes the elephant in the room when the patient is complaining of pain and painful sex. It's the sexual pain that becomes the most important problem if the patient's directly asked. Back problems, coccyx injuries, again, very important because some patients with vulval pain have referred pain to the vulva from these, from back problems or coccygeal injuries. If we look at management of women with vulvodynia, then we have some evidence-produced guidelines on the management of vulvodynia from the British Society for the Study of Vulval Diseases. And their website is www.bssvd.org. And this website has the guidelines available online. This organisation draws in a number of specialties from gynaecology, dermatology and GU medicine, and they produce these guidelines to look at all the available high quality evidence relating to the management of vulvodynia. So I'm briefly going to touch on some of those points in the next few slides. When it comes to management, I've divided the categories into medical treatments, sexual therapy, physical treatments, and holistic. Medical treatments, we're referring to treatments that are generally available from doctors, drugs on prescription, for example, injection, surgery. Sexual therapy would be delivered by perhaps a psychosexual therapist. Physical treatments, now this is mainly going to focus on desensitizing the vulval area. This would be generally given again by a physiotherapist. And then the holistic treatments, this can be anything from exercise, breathing exercises, relaxation, meditation, yoga, etc. Anything that suits the patient. But it's just really an acknowledgement that those are for her to look into. Perhaps the most important initial part of managing vulvodynia is this issue of psychoeducation, explaining to the patient what the condition is. Psychoeducation is crucially important. Usually the patients, when they've had vulval pain for an average 1 to 2 years, get stuck in a void of not only symptoms, but an inadequate treatment plan, an absent diagnosis. In that void, they can fill their minds with all sorts of worries about fertility, spreading to other parts of the body, cancer, etc., etc. So we generally, when we give vulvodynia diagnosis, explain what the condition is, give them reassurance on all the different issues, such as fertility, infection, passing on to partners and that. But I don't think that's enough. I think there needs to be a discussion with the patient about chronic pain. And it's setting this ground is very important, I think, because it will give the foundation for the patient to then try some of the treatment strategies that will on the face of it not be very attractive, i.e. the antidepressant drugs. I tend to talk about, with chronic pain, this issue of function within the nerve endings, the nociceptors in the skin, this issue of allodynia, the reprogramming of nerve endings from a touch pressure to a pain sensation, how this passes up through the spinal cord into the pain centre of the brain and return down to the vulva where the pain is felt. And to stress the importance of what is essentially the chronic pain process, the chronic pain cycle that inherently involves the pain centre in the brain. I perhaps draw as an analogy those patients with phantom limb pain to illustrate this. So diabetics who have amputations because of leg ulcers still feel pain in the amputation. And this is because over a period of time, usually more than 6 months, sometimes 3 months, chronic pain process has developed, which involves the brain, and therefore it's not just the vulva, it's the brain as well. I cover things like two things, amplification and memory of pain. So amplification of pain is essentially this issue of allodynia, of touch of the vulva leading to an exaggerated sense of pain because of the nerve endings malfunctioning, and that what strategies we need to help reduce pain involve reducing this level of amplification, reducing the level of touch sensitivity in the vulva. And there are a number of ways we can do that, and an example would be drugs, for example. The other issue I talk about is memory of pain. No doubt a lot of patients have a chronic background pain with acute flare-ups, and it's these acute flare-ups that patients find incredibly distressing. And so what we try and teach patients is to try and focus on triggers that will cause a memory of pain to show itself. What are those triggers? How can the patient deal with them? The most obvious thing is sex, to cause a trigger of pain. But it's just acknowledging that amplification and memory are important characteristics of chronic pain. And those are going to be the strategies to deal with, reduce amplification and to identify triggers in pain. I think education is crucial, and this is a paper carried out in Canada where patients with provoked vestibular dyspnea underwent educational-led seminars, group therapy essentially, run by gynaecologists, and there was basic information on vulval anatomy, physiology, pain management, skin care and a sexual function, i.e. psychoeducation. And this paper shows a sustained benefit to the patients when these seminars were carried out. I'm now going to start focusing on the first of the four principles of treatment, the first one being medical treatments. By medical treatments, I mean usually prescription-based drugs or creams which you need to get from your doctor. Now, there are a number of treatments available for women with unprovoked pain that are very effective. As I mentioned, unprovoked vulvodynia is like other chronic pain conditions where there is what we call neuropathic pain or nerve ending type pain. The first line treatments of neuropathic pain is tricyclic antidepressant drugs such as amitriptyline and nortriptyline. In fact, NICE guidance is that amitriptyline is the drug of choice for neuropathic pain. And we use this on a titrating regime starting at 10 milligrams at night, increasing by 10 milligrams every 4 to 5 days, or even slower depending on the patient. An upper dose would be around 75 to 100 milligrams a day. And just some advice really on amitriptyline and nortriptyline. It's best taken at night. The side effects usually do settle after 10 to 14 days. The average dose is around 60 milligrams. So patients have to really be quite encouraged when they start taking these tablets and warned, especially of the side effects. I found nortriptyline has a slightly better side effect profile than amitriptyline, and I would use nortriptyline over amitriptyline because of its because of less dry mouth, less tiredness. Second line drugs as well include gabapentin and Lyrica. These drugs are used for neuropathic pain, and again they're used on an increasing dosage regime, a titrated dose. Now there is evidence, as I say, for tricyclics and gabapentin working in women with neuropathic pain and also vulvodynia. So I think it's certainly worth trying these drugs as a first-line treatment. They can be combined if there is an optimal dosage on one, but not quite enough pain relief, the drugs can be combined together. Third-line drugs are drugs like such as tramadol and other antidepressant drugs, but these would really be beyond a prescription for the average hospital doctor and GP, and many patients probably need, with severe pain that need third-line treatment, probably should be seen by the chronic pain team. Acupuncture and anaesthetic gels are also there. Acupuncture is a good chronic pain strategy. There is some evidence that this works for vulvodynia. And anaesthetic gels can numb the skin. One has to be aware of irritancy on the skin because gels sometimes contain alcohol, so it can sting. But generally, all these treatments should be tried together at the same time to produce, hopefully, an overall a reduction in pain levels. And the evidence today from trials today suggests that's roughly about 30 to 50% reduction in pain levels, and the most benefit coming from the drugs, the tricyclics and gabapentin. When it comes to vestibulodynia, this is a problem of touch sensitivity, and patients can have purely sexual pain, or if they're not sexually active, or even if they are sexually active, they can get a lot of pain just from, for example, tight clothing, and that triggers off the memory of pain and they get a flare-up. Generally, the strategies used in the previous slide aren't used first line, and I would tend to favour a desensitising of the area. Desensitising literally mean make less sensitive the area through usually physical treatments. That could be anything from massage with a finger, vaginal trainers, the Amiel or the Femmax vaginal trainers to help relax the pelvic floor muscles, pelvic floor exercises, a vibrator, a very simple soft vibrator just to produce some vibratory sensation in the area of pain, and biofeedback, which is not routinely available in the country, is another option, and that's had the most, we've had the most experience in the literature from Dr. Glazer's work in America. But they all in essence do the same. They make the vulval area and the pelvic floor area less sensitive, less tight, less painful. Anaesthetic gels I put at the bottom because there may be some benefit from the regular use of 5% lidocaine ointment nightly. Rather than use it as and when, use it on a regular basis nightly on a cotton wool ball when passed into the vagina, vulval area. Zotun's work showed that this did actually reduce allodynia when patients were followed up with a nightly use of 5% lignocaine ointment on a cotton wool ball. Sexual therapy is incredibly important because many patients who've got vulvodynia are quite phobic about touching the vulval area. There's avoidance of intercourse, there's avoidance of any intimacy sometimes. This can lead to reduced sex drive and vaginismus, poor lubrication. There's a real knock-on effect. So I think there is a great role for a sexual therapist in the management of women with provoked pain. So I think a referral is very important at an early stage rather than a later stage. It's really how we as doctors sell this to patients, and I do tell patients to try and invest a bit of time in seeing in the therapist, and it's really as an adjunct to all the other treatments that we're going to offer patients, such as the drugs, the acupuncture, the anaesthetic gels, etc. But sometimes for patients with pain and sexual pain, a number of problems, it's the sexual pain that becomes the most important issue. I'm not going to cover physical treatments in this lecture because there is a podcast attached to the website, and Helen Forth from the Royal Free Hospital, who's a physiotherapist, is going to talk about some of the physical treatments for vulval pain. When we talk about physical treatments, we're really talking about physiotherapy type interventions to try and make less hypertonic the pelvic floor. A lot of evidence to show that there is dysfunction in the levator muscles in women with vulvodynia. The muscles are tight and they're poorly functioning and they're not able to relax or contract like a normal muscle. And again, I think seeing a physiotherapist for this type of treatment is an adjunct to all the other treatments. Holistic therapy, I think this is really just an acknowledgement that there are non-medical ways of managing chronic pain. And in an ideal world with time in the clinics, one would have a discussion with a patient about lifestyle changes, exercise, any form of stress-relieving strategy the patient wants to do. I think with chronic pain, you do get a number of both social and behavioural changes that might involve putting weight on, drinking too much alcohol, side effects from the medications. Chronic pain can give bad backs, can give stiffness, etc., etc. This is what I mean by holistic management. Just recognizing these knock-on effects of chronic pain and telling the patient to try and fit in some sort of way of addressing the problem. So just in summary and some tips, I think it's important to spend some time explaining to the patient a bit about chronic pain, talking about pain memory and amplification. I think treatments should be combined as much as possible. Patients do need encouragement, particularly with some of the drugs. Patients need time to think things through. They need to do their homework, and I usually direct them to the VPS website and tell them to self-manage. This issue of self-management for chronic pain is incredibly important, really. We have to move away slightly from this medical model of prescription given to these patients. Individually, I think we have to look at our own skills when it comes to these patients, because vulval pain encompasses so many different facets, from chronic pain, sexual therapy, vulval examination, to the whole host of different treatments. And I guess as doctors we have limited numbers of skills, limited numbers of things we can give patients, our toolkit as it were. And we might have to define in our own minds what we want to treat patients with before asking other health professionals to come in. A very clear example would be things like sexual therapy and physiotherapy. Those are patients we generally refer on. Something not so clear might be the prescription of drugs for vulval pain. Many doctors are happy giving amitriptyline, nortriptyline, but they're not happy about giving gabapentin, pregabalin. So it may be that these sort of patients who are needing more advanced pain management strategies need to be referred onwards. And this leads on to a framework of care for women with vulvodynia. I usually divide these women up into complicated and uncomplicated. So an uncomplicated patient is one that responds quite well to basic treatment. When I say basic treatment, the psychoeducation, the nortriptyline drugs, acupuncture, somebody who's responding, managing well, has the information and is quite happy to be left in an open appointment. But sometimes individual patients will need more than that. And this is where I think a team can be very important. If we look at a team, then we're looking at perhaps a lead person, a lead clinician, to take charge of the overall package of care for the patient. And that lead is going to be making the diagnosis, starting basic treatment, and then importantly referring patients out to physio, psychosexual therapy, even pain management clinics. So patients might have quite a number of hospital visits to make for their treatment. But as long as patients are almost signed up for that, I think it's worth it. When patients aren't really engaged in treatment, they're not really wanting to come to the hospital for treatment, they're half-heartedly taking their treatment, they're not attending clinics, then I think you've got probably a patient that's not going to respond well. Our other colleagues, for example, pain management, have access to a whole host of other things in their toolkit: nerve blocks, pain management courses, sometimes access to clinical psychologists that in our specialty we can find difficulty getting. So it's essentially a multidisciplinary team. I'm not arguing for more new clinics to be established, but it might be styles of working within a hospital. Just finally, a little bit about the Vulval Pain Society, which we set up in 1996 as an information and support network to women with vulval pain. Most of our work is focused on the website and also workshops, which are carried out twice a year around the country. And this is my last slide. The doctor-patient relationship, well, I think as doctors, there is a perception that women with vulvodynia can be difficult to deal with. They're angry, they're complicated, complex, and they take a lot of time. Well, that's one point of view. However, if you look at it from the patient's point of view, and this is feedback I've had from patients, patients say, not infrequently, that they're not taken seriously, there's never enough time to discuss their problems, they always see different doctors when they come to the clinic, there's rarely a cause given or basic information, there's no instruction on treatment, for example, tricyclics, there never seems to be a plan, and there's no access if there is a problem. And an example of that would be a tricyclic given to a patient without instruction, and the patient gets dryness, dizziness soon after taking the tablet, and then has to stop because of symptoms. And there's no way in to the system to see that doctor, and the patient's left in limbo till the next appointment, which is 3 months' time. So it's quite interesting to get these patient this patient perspective. And on the basis of this, what I try and do is myself see the patient the same time she comes. I've got a whole array of fact sheets. For difficult patients, I might make a double slot, and I always send the patient a copy of a GP letter, and at the top of the letter there is access to the clinic should there be a problem. It's always better to know there's a problem rather than see the patient 3-6 months later and the treatment's not been tried. So I hope this lecture has been of help. If you really would like more information, then please contact me at the Vulval Pain Society. Thank you for listening.